Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Martin Bean. I am the very proud Vice-Chancellor of the Open University, and it is absolutely wonderful to be here in Belfast to celebrate with you this afternoon. And by the authority given in the statutes of the Open University, I declare this congregation open for the conferment of degrees and the presentation of graduates. Distinguished guests, graduates, and friends of the university, it is my privilege and pleasure to welcome you to the 9th of the Open University's degree ceremonies being held in 2014. And we are delighted to welcome our special guests who have found time in their busy diaries to be with us today. From the Northern Ireland Assembly, we welcome Dr. Stephen Farry, MLA, Minister for Employment and Learning, Dr. David Ford, MLA, Minister for Justice, and Mr. Robin Swan, MLA, Chair of the Employment and Learning Committee. At our degree ceremony in Belfast last year, Minister Farry, MLA, announced that the Open University would be funded through his department from the 1st of August 2013, thus finally completing the devolution process of our teaching activities in Northern Ireland, Scotland, and Wales. And I have to tell you, this change has transformed the way we work for the people of Northern Ireland, making us a full partner in the higher education system here. I'd also like to welcome from the Houses of Parliament the Right Honourable Geoffrey Donaldson, MP, from Academia, Professor Richard Barnett, the Vice-Chancellor of the University of Ulster, whose presence demonstrates the warm welcome we are receiving from Northern Ireland's excellent universities. We are also delighted to welcome back honorary graduates whose awards were conferred in previous years, Dame Mary Peters, Sir Kenneth Bloomfield, Reverend Harold Good, and Hilary Bracefield. It is so good to have you all back with us. And finally, it is my great pleasure to welcome today's honorary graduate, John Lord Alderdice, and we are so delighted to have us with him today, and I'm sure his remarks later are going to be inspirational for us as we share this afternoon together. I personally am thrilled to be back in Belfast and to hear all about the many ways the OU helps contribute to community life in this city. For example, our collaboration with Belfast City Council on our University of the Air public art installation, which featured local artists, poets and writers, and which involved the grounds of the Belfast City Hall, the Ulster Hall, and of course, our own OU headquarters in Victoria Street. We're excited to be part of the city's emerging digital strategy through our work with the council producing free educational content. And I'm sure some of you might have spotted that our branding turned a rather fetching shade of pink for the Giro d'Italia cycle race when it came to town a couple of weeks ago. And our involvement didn't stop with the new look though. We were also proud to launch some brand new free learning material about the race, about cycling and Belfast to coincide with the event. All of you here today are a testament to the Open University's popularity in Northern Ireland, and I continue to be so very proud of the fantastic work our staff do every day to support our students. It was truly delightful to see this recognised in the most recent National Student Survey, where the Open University in Northern Ireland was ranked number one for student satisfaction. Each year, the Open University awards over 14,000 degrees throughout 2014. More than 7,000 of the graduates are being presented for their qualifications at degree ceremonies just like this one here today in Belfast. These are being held in 13 different towns and cities throughout the UK, as well as in Dublin, in Versailles, and in other places as far apart as Moscow, Bucharest, and Addis Ababa. This illustrates the extraordinary scale and reach of the Open University, underlining the fact that today you are joining a worldwide community of graduates. Now, it goes without saying that today is a very important occasion in the life of you, our graduates, your families and loved ones, as well as the university staff who I hope you feel have nurtured and supported you along the way. And you could be forgiven for feeling that this occasion is so important that it needs to be solemn. And you would be quite wrong. In every sense, this day is a day of celebration. So I will be very disappointed if anyone crosses the stage this afternoon to anything less than thunderous applause or whatever other way you choose to express your appreciation here in Belfast this afternoon. So with that in mind, first instruction from the Vice-Chancellor today. Would all of our graduates please stand? Yes, that's all of you in the fetching robes. Up you get. Can everybody in the room give them a big round of applause for what they've achieved? Well done. So let me tell you how this afternoon's going to work. Today's ceremony will begin with the presentation of those graduates who have gained a higher degree and who have been able to attend here today. And they will be presented by Mrs. Heather Laird, our Assistant Director of the Open University in Northern Ireland. We will then see the awarding of the honorary degree of Doctor of the University to Lord Alderdice, and Mr. John Darcy, our Director of the Open University in Northern Ireland, will present Lord Alderdice, who will come across here and sign our graduates' book, and then share some remarks with us. Then we will continue our presentation of graduates with those who have gained first degrees. They will be presented by Mr. John Addy, another one of our assistant directors of the Open University in Northern Ireland, and then I'll be back just to share a few thoughts with you before we go off and enjoy this beautiful, sunny Belfast afternoon. So ladies and gentlemen, sit back. Relax, graduates, congratulations. I'll see you up here in a few minutes. You're in for a treat. Enjoy the afternoon. Thank you very much.
Vice-Chancellor, I shall now present graduates who have gained higher degrees and have been able to attend here today. I present to you the degree of Master of Arts in Art History, Helen Honeymoon. For the degree of Master of Arts in History, Ron Carson. For the degree of Master of Arts in History, Shane O'Reilly. For the degree of Master of Arts in Religious Studies, Geraldine Gracie. Social Sciences, Robert Simpson.
Hi, Robert, how are you?
For the degree of Master of Business Administration, I present Leslie Allen.
Hi, Leslie.
Margaret Craig. Gareth Duncan.
Hi, Gareth. How are you? Very well.
Angus Fee. Adele Callaghan.
Hi, Adele, how are you?
For the degree of Master of Education, I present Sonia Darcy.
Hi, Sonia, how are you?
Christine Wilkinson.
Hi, Christine.
For the degree of Master of Science in Advanced Networking, I present Stephen Duncan. For the degree of Master of Science in Development Management, I present Gerald Lilburn. Hazel Thierry.
Hi, Hazel.
For the degree of Master of Science in Environmental Decision Making, I present Grania Mackie. For the degree of Master of Science in Forensic Psychology and Criminology, I present Kieran Grant. Ewan Robb. For the degree of Master of Science in International Finance and Management, I present Philip Quinn. For the degree of Master of Science in Mathematics, I present Roy Mitchell. For the degree of Master of Science in Psychology, I present John Langtree.
Hello, John.
Roger Waters. In software development, I present Thomas Devine.
Hey, Thomas.
And for the postgraduate certificate in education, I present Chris Hunter.
Hey, Chris.
And Martin Souter.
Hello, Martin.
Vice-Chancellor, colleagues, graduates and guests, peace is about getting people to disagree without killing each other. This stark definition offered by John Alderdice put into context the need for peace in Northern Ireland. As leader of the Alliance Party, John played a strong and significant role in the peace process as one of the key negotiators of the Belfast Agreement, which was signed on Good Friday 1998. Born in 1955, the son of a Presbyterian minister and educated in Donaghcloney, Belfast and Ballymena Academy, John went to Queen's University Belfast in 1971 to study medicine, graduating in 1978. He specialised in psychoanalytic psychiatry and in 1988 was appointed as Ireland's first consultant psychotherapist. However, it was his political and peace-building contributions that established John Alderdice as a world leader. Elected Alliance leader in 1987, he was voted on to Belfast City Council in 1989 and again in 1993, topping the poll in the Victoria area of East Belfast. In 1994, after the ceasefires, he took Alliance into the Forum for Peace and Reconciliation, established by the Irish government at Dublin Castle. Now, this was significant, as Alliance was the only non-nationalist party there. He led Alliance into the Northern Ireland Forum for Political Dialogue in 1996 and in the multi-party talks chaired by Senator George Mitchell. That same year, John was raised to the peerage as Baron Alderdice, taking his seat on the Liberal Democrat benches, one of the youngest life peers ever. In 1998, he led Alliance at the inter-party and inter-government talks in Belfast, London and Dublin on the future of Northern Ireland. And in July 1998, he was appointed Speaker of the new Northern Ireland Assembly, responsible for chairing its plenary sessions and developing the new procedures and administration here. On the international front, he was from 1999 to 2003 an elected Vice President of the European Liberals, and from 2005 to 2009, he served as elected president of Liberal International, the global organization of some 100 liberal political parties. In 2004, Lord Alderdice was appointed a commissioner of the Independent Monitoring Commission and retired as Assembly Speaker. The Independent Monitoring Commission is widely felt to have been a substantial element in achieving the full implementation of the Good Friday Agreement and in the stabilisation of the new power-sharing government arrangements here in Northern Ireland. He served throughout the Commission's tenure until the final report was published in 2011. After the 2010 Westminster election, John was elected to chair the Liberal Democrat Parliamentary Party at the House of Lords, continuing in this role until February of this year, when he stepped down to become the founding director of the Centre for the Resolution of Intractable Conflict at Harris Manchester College in Oxford. This move reflects John Alderdice's long-standing academic and practical work on conflicts across the world, especially in the Middle East, where he has often cautioned that peace processes are rarely short-term projects. Engagement, respect, patience, and dialogue are the trademarks of John Alderdice, no doubt influenced by his professional training in the medical and behavioural sciences, but most notably in his contribution to the building of the new political structures and peace in Northern Ireland. Vice Chancellor, by the authority of the Senate, I present to you for the degree of Doctor of the University, John Alderdice.
Vice-Chancellor, National Director, Ministers, Parliamentarians from London and Belfast, academic staff, distinguished guests, fellow graduates, ladies and gentlemen, it's an enormous pleasure to be with all of you here and a profound honour to become part of the Open University family. It's funny being back in this big hall because I actually remember the debates we had in Belfast City Council about building the hall. I remember Sammy Wilson, who of course is a much more respectable figure nowadays, describing this as the most expensive band hall in Belfast. Sinn Féin were speaking rather constructively about the building of the hall, no doubt appreciating that a number of their constituents just across in the markets area were likely to get good jobs in it. So Sammy confronted Alex Maskey, who was the Sinn Féin whip at the time, across the chamber and said, "Well, Alex, does that mean you're not going to blow it up then?" To which Alex responded, And that was the first indication that some of us in politics got that Sinn Féin and the IRA were moving away from violence and towards a new political future. It's a long time ago, and it seems, in some ways, even longer ago, because so much has changed and changed for the better. And I'm sure if Sammy had known that this hall was going to be used for graduations of the Open University, he wouldn't have worried what the price of it was, because he would have known what a wonderful organization and institution was going to use it to celebrate today the achievements of so many of you here who have worked so long and so hard for your degrees. One of the things that really excites me about the Open University is the fact that it is addressing new things in new ways. Now, lots of universities are historic places. They've been around a long time. They've built up a culture and an expertise and an understanding, which is very valuable. But it's possible to get stuck in old ways of doing things, old ways of doing politics, old ways of doing relationships, old ways of even doing academic work. But the Open University was created to take a whole new approach to the emerging technologies, particularly information and communications technology. And these aren't just a bit of a new way of doing things. These are an enormous step forward. This is like the development of language, the development of logic as a way of thinking, and very particularly, the development of printing with its capacity to expand and develop and transmit knowledge. We haven't even the beginnings of an idea of the social and political and intellectual revolutions that are going to come from this progress. And Open University is right at the forefront, not just within the United Kingdom and the Republic of Ireland, but globally, we're part of a leader. That's very exciting. But the second thing that excites me about the Open University is, despite the technology, it hasn't lost its concern about the human dimension, about people. You know, sometimes in academic life, you can get so bound up in the facts and the figures and ticking the boxes and writing the papers that you can kind of forget that what this is all about is about people. You know, when we're learning something, we're not just learning facts. We're learning them from a person. When you read a book, you're reading the thoughts of a person. And when you come to the end and you think, that's a really good book, you don't just say, I'm going to buy another book. You say, I wonder if there's anything else that author has written. Because fundamentally, learning is about taking things in from other people. And that's very much the case in the Open University. Despite all the technology, the valuing of people and the society in which we live is manifestly valued by everyone from our vice chancellor down in the university. And I think that's a really tremendous thing. But there's a third important thing about Open University. You know, quite a lot of young people nowadays sort of drift into university. They come through primary school and they go to secondary level and they kind of slide into university, not always being clear as to why they're doing it. None of you drifted into the Open University. You made a decision that this was something that was going to serve the purposes that you wanted for your life. There's a great motto for Open University, which is learn and live. The motto for my school in Ballymena was 10x per posite, which means get a purpose and stick to it. The college that I work in now in Oxford doesn't take young people below the age of 21. And one of the reasons is they want young people to go and work out what's their purpose and then come to build. That's what all of you have done. You've done other things, you've explored other things, and you've decided that this is something that you wanted to do. It wasn't necessarily easy. In fact, sometimes it was quite difficult. And I guess maybe sometimes you even thought it was pretty impossible. Well, one of the messages of the Open University is the impossible takes a while longer. That's all. It doesn't mean it can't be done. And when we stick with those things that are difficult, we get to a marvelous day like today, which is a celebration, it's an achievement, but it's also a platform to move forward. In what kind of a way? Well, I'd say three things to you about it. First of all, keep finding out about finding out. What do I mean by that? I mean, don't just keep finding out new facts, getting new bits of information, acquiring more qualifications. Keep developing your understanding of things. When you come to something that looks like an answer, I'm afraid this problem is intractable, this violence can't be stopped, don't accept that answer. Say, why? What makes it intractable? How can we reframe it so that it's no longer an intractable problem? Well, somebody comes along to you with a psychological problem and they speak in a strange way, they behave in a strange way. Don't just say, here's the diagnosis. Say, why did this person fall ill in this particular way at this particular time? And then you begin to find a way of taking them out of it. That's the second thing. Don't just keep finding out about finding out. Keep finding out about how to make a difference. Because it's not enough to just get degrees and learn more. It's about making a difference in your life and to society. In the political world, one of the real tragedies is that political scientists and politicians don't work very much together. The politicians despise the political scientists because they say, you guys could never get elected. And the political scientists despise the politicians because they say, you don't know what you're doing. And actually, they've got to find ways of working together. There's no way in medicine that we would try to construct medicine without research and a respect for the academic. But there's no way we'd value medicine if we never learned how to take people from illness to health. And finally, don't be too afraid to follow your star. You know, sometimes we can be too sensible. We know what we'd really, really like to do, but it's not for us, it's for somebody else. It's too difficult, it's not possible. You know from coming through Open University that it is possible, and as you go on from here, don't be afraid to follow your star and follow the possibilities. Now, I've already spoken for too long, and I don't apologize for the enthusiasm and the passion for this that made me speak too long. I just apologize for the time that I've postponed some of you graduates getting up to see this wonderful Vice Chancellor and shaking by the hand. But I do want to take an opportunity, like I'm sure you do too, to say a very sincere thank you, not just to Open University and to the staff, but to our family and friends and all of those who have helped to support us. Some of mine are here today, particularly my wife Joan, my son Stephen, and there are also some political colleagues that you might notice too who've been pretty helpful and supportive over the years, people from a number of the parties. And I appreciate that, like you appreciate very much the support you've had. This isn't just called the Open University because it's open to people from all classes and creeds and backgrounds, and increasingly open to people right across the world. I think it's called the Open University because it opens up new doors and new paths to understanding, and I think we can all celebrate that today. Thank you.
Vice Chancellor, we now come to the part of today's ceremony that marks the presentation of graduates who have gained a first degree and have been able to attend here today. The full subject and classification details are printed in the Directory of Graduates. I present to you for the degree of Bachelor of Arts with First Class Honours, Jill Donnan. Bernard Donnelly.
Hello, Bernard.
Jason Purdy.
Hi, Jason. How are you?
Darren Rogers. Degree of Bachelor of Arts with Honours, I present Radko Belkovic.
Hello,
Rebecca Black.
Hi, Rebecca. How are you?
Sarah Black.
Hi, Sarah.
Catherine Bolton.
Hello, Catherine.
Michael Boyd.
Hey, Michael, how are you?
Good morning.
Louise Burkham.
Hi, Louise.
Claire Colton.
Hi, Claire.
John Daly.
Hello, John.
Valerie Davison. Paul Derrick.
Hello, Paul. How are you?
Rachel Graham.
Hi, Rachel. How are
Catherine Heffernan.
Hi, Catherine, how are you?
Michael Irwin.
Hello, Michael.
Yone Lothaga Lagara. Gareth McAllister.
Hi, Gareth. How are you?
Paul McGorian. Wendy McCool.
Hello, Wendy.
Connor McCrory.
Hey, Connor,
Andrew McCulloch.
Hi, Andrew. How are you?
Linda McGrath.
Hi, Linda.
Leslie Ann McKeown. Claire Meenahan.
Hi, Claire, how are you?
Peter Morgan.
Hi, Peter. How are you?
Kathy Nelson.
Hi, Kathy. How are you?
Aideen O'Caroin. Elaine O'Donovan.
Hi, Elaine.
Mike Redman.
Hey, Mike, how are you?
Lorraine Simmons. Liam Smith. Brian Turner. Malachi Vaughan. Catherine Walsh.
Hi, Catherine.
Joanne Webster.
Hi, Joanne.
Steve Wellings.
Hi, Steve. How are you?
For the degree of Bachelor of Arts, I present Kerry Milligan.
Hi, Kerry. How are you?
Roisin Tyler.
Hi, Roisin. How are you?
For the degree of Bachelor of Engineering with Honours, I present Chris Arnold.
Hey, Chris, how are you?
Andrew McCulloch.
G'day, Andrew, how are you?
Stephen McGee.
Hi, Stephen. How are you?
Good job.
David Smith.
Hi, David.
And for the degree of Bachelor of Laws with First Class Honours, Karen Brady.
Hi.
Michelle Shaw.
Hi, Michelle, how are you?
For the degree of Bachelor of Laws with Honours, Catherine McCavanagh. The degree of Bachelor of Science with First Class Honours, Magella Feeney.
Hi,
the degree of Bachelor of Science with Honours, I present Yana Bailey.
Hi, Yana.
Stephen Blakely.
Hi, Stephen.
Neil Brennan.
Hey, Neil, how are you? How are
you? Justin Carroll.
Hey, Justin.
Kimberly Coates.
Hi, Kimberly. How are you?
Podrig Collum.
How are you?
Mary Curtin. Victoria Davidson.
Hello.
William Davis.
Hey, William, how are you?
Sheila Donnelly.
Hello, Sheila.
Gillian Duffy.
Hello, Gillian.
Robert Elliott.
Hello, Robert.
Adrian Gilmore. Stephen Goan.
Hello, Stephen. How are you?
Stuart Gowdy.
Hello, Stuart. How are you?
Lynn Greaves.
Hi,
Lynn. Martina Murray Granova.
Hello, Martina.
Ruth Hart.
Hello, Ruth. How are you?
Noreen Hayward.
Hello, Noreen. How are you?
Michael Healy.
Hey, Michael. How are you?
Karen Henry.
Hey, Karen.
Una Hobson.
Hello, Una. How are you?
Terence Jackson.
How are you, Terence?
Terence Linda Kilpatrick.
Hi, Linda.
Janet Layton.
Hello, Janet, how are you?
Ruth Loizides.
Hello, Ruth, how are you?
Anna McCrae. John McCarthy.
Hello, John.
Margaret McCullough.
Hello, Margaret.
Pat McDonald. Julie McGookin.
Hi, Julie.
Sam McNeil.
Hey, Sam.
Owen Moore.
Hey, Owen.
Alexandra Mousseen.
Hello, Alexandra.
Tina North.
Hi, Tina. How are you?
Angela O'Rourke. Kerry Patton. Lauren Radwell.
Hello, Lauren.
John Ralston.
Hello, John.
Carmella Simpson. Joe Skeets.
Hello, Joe.
For the degree of Bachelor of Science, I present Karen Agnew.
Hi, Karen.
Brenda Burney.
Hello, Brenda.
Maria Bradley.
Hi, Maria.
James Donnelly.
Hello, James.
and James's wife, Caroline Donnelly. Joanna Toner. Paula McVeigh.
It's a pleasure to meet you. Welcome. Very proud of you.
Ashley Nicol. Andrew Sheridan.
Hi, Andrew. How are you?
Thank you.
Kathleen Wilkinson.
Hi, Kathleen.
Prince Young Owolanki. For a foundation degree, I present Sean Ryan.
Hey, Sean, how are you?
And for the Diploma of Higher Education, I present Gerald Bresnahan. Maureen Brown.
Hi, Maureen.
Donna Carlin.
Hey, Donna, how are you?
Claire Klinging.
Hi, Claire.
Amanda Davis.
Hi, Amanda.
Andrea Devlin.
Hi, Andrea.
Eugene Douglas. Kerry Gallagher. Gemma Gray Caldwell. Heather Hollywood.
Hello, Heather.
Anna Jones.
Hi, Anna.
Roisin Killen.
Hi, Roisin.
Well done. Alana Kirk.
Hi.
John Lindop.
Hi, John.
Margaret Lynch.
Hi, Margaret. How are you?
Tracy McAllister. Brenda McIlroy.
Hello, Brenda. How are you?
Mary Frances McKelvey.
Well done.
Margaret McMullen.
Hello.
Catherine Niblock. Melissa Patterson. Julie Phillips. Angela Ratter.
Hello, Angela.
Lynn Reed.
Hi, Lynn. How are you?
Elizabeth Rogers.
Hi.
Emma Shields.
Hi, Emma. How are you?
Caroline Sloan. Keith Stewart.
Hi, Keith.
Jill Tasker.
Hi, Jill. How are you?
Angela Trainer.
Let's give them all another big round of applause. Well done, graduates. Yay. Good job. Well, good afternoon again, everybody, and thank you so much for coming along today. Our graduates, guests, staff, everyone, everybody for sharing what I promised you was going to be an amazing afternoon, and so it was. Although this is the first degree ceremony I've had with a while where somebody didn't snap a selfie with me on stage, so you're clearly much better behaved here in Belfast than in other places that I preside over. You know, this is without doubt the best part of my job. Not because I necessarily enjoy shaking hundreds and hundreds of sweaty palms, but because I get to see close up hundreds and hundreds of joyful expressions. It was there in the eyes of each and every one of you as you crossed the stage with us this afternoon. It's sort of a blend of elation, nervousness, and a little bit of relief, and occasionally some blind panic. Above all, though, there's just this amazing, overwhelming, gleeful delight at having achieved something incredible. And that's no overstatement. What you have done, graduates, is incredible. And today is a really important day for you, and one that I want you to remember for the rest of your life. But I also know that big moments like this can all too easily pass you by in a blur of emotion and adrenaline. So I want you to take a moment, take a breath, slow it all down, and make sure you have a chance to take everything in. From here, I can look out at a sea of faces, no two exactly alike. You're all individuals. You're all unique. You're all different. But from today until forever, you will have one thing in common. You can proudly call yourself a graduate of the Open University. It's more than 40 years since our first degree ceremony, and since then, hundreds of thousands of amazing people have studied for countless hours to earn the right to sit where you are sitting today. And you know far better than I do how much work they undertook, how much effort and determination they needed. You know more than I could ever express just how great an achievement this is for you. But it's not just your achievement, it's ours too, the university's. The advisor in registrations who handled your first hesitant telephone inquiry, the academics in Milton Keynes who designed and wrote your course, the student services staff who supported you when, quite frankly, you felt like you just could not go on. And of course, our associate lecturers, the women and men who guided you through the whole OU learning experience from the moment you opened that brown cardboard box full of course materials to the moment you crossed the stage with us today. Every one of us at the Open University has a little stake in what you've accomplished, and believe me, every one of us is bursting with pride when we see you celebrating today. It was the Open University staff who made all this possible, and many of them, I'm very proud to say, are with me on the stage today. So graduates, on behalf of everybody that supported you, can you just give an expression of thanks to all of the wonderful people I get to work with at the Open University? Now, of course, they're not the only ones who helped you reach your goal. Now, I know it's not easy being an OU student. I know that for many of you, you completed your studies while holding down demanding, challenging jobs, looking after your families, and overcoming tremendous obstacles along the way. But I also know there is only one thing harder than being an OU student, and that's living with an OU student. So I'd also like to take a moment for you to pay tribute to your family and friends. We should pay tribute to them for supporting you when you were getting going, for standing by you when the things were getting tough, and for celebrating with you now in your moment of glory. And do you know what? I suspect they won't miss your study any more than you will. The impassioned orations over breakfast on the joys of cubism, the challenges facing international development, or the wave theories of light. The detailed running commentaries on your TMAs, 1,000 words, 1,001 words, 1,002 words, and your cries of desperation. The deadline's not until midnight. I have 3 more minutes to submit. So this is your time, graduates, to acknowledge the support you have received from your family and friends who are with us here today. Why don't you, graduates, stand up and give your friends and family a fantastic round of applause. That you can do better than that. Big round of applause. Find them in the audience. Tell them what they mean.
Good job. Graduates, you know when you first announced that you were going to study with the Open University? Do you remember how many people said, you won't be able to get the qualification, it's going to be too hard? They didn't think that you could sit right where you're sitting today. And when the work got tough and the deadline stacked up, how many of you questioned whether you could carry on? But here's the thing. You did. You carried on, you proved the cynics wrong, and today you get your reward. And if you can do that, there really is no limit to what you can achieve in the future. The question is, where will the future take you? What should you do with that hard-earned qualification? The best advice I can give is summed up by just three words that Lord Alderdice shared with us that are staring back at you from the programs that you've got. They're on the university crest. Learn and live. So let's start with learn. This may feel like the end of your learning experience, but I'd like to think it's just the beginning of a lifelong journey for you. Now you can learn how to take your qualification to improve your own life and the lives of those around you. You can use it to open new doors and learn what lies on the other side. Discover new experiences and learn what they will tell you about yourself and the wider world. As long as you keep on learning, you'll also succeed with the other half of the equation. And it's so important that you keep on living, making the most of every day for yourself and for those whose lives you influence. Why? Well, a little over 50 years ago, Martin Luther King Jr. was locked in an Alabama jail cell. As he sat there, he wrote an open letter to the New York Times magazine, a letter that described how, and I quote, "We are caught in an inescapable web of mutuality, and that whatever affects one directly affects us all indirectly." Half a century later, those words ring truer than ever. We live in a world that is more connected, more engaged than at any point in our history. Continents long divided by mountains and separated by oceans have been united by technology. And that's why what you've done, what you've learned, matters so much. Because it benefits not just you, but it benefits everyone in that web of mutuality. Your community, your country, your family, even your world. You need to go out there and live your life in a way that puts your qualifications and knowledge to the best possible use. Because we certainly live in challenging times. We face problems economic, environmental, social, unlike any of those tackled by our forebears. But they are problems that can be overcome, and it falls to you, the people with open minds and limitless possibilities, to overcome them. Seize the opportunities that life presents. Make yourself a global citizen, a significant member of the human race, someone who matters, someone who lives. The late Nelson Mandela, also one of our honorary graduates, said that education is the greatest weapon we have to change the world. And that may seem a grand ambition, but you've already changed your world, and with it, you've changed the world of everyone in your web of mutuality. So remember to learn how to change yourself, how to change your community, how to change the world. And remember to live the life of a global citizen, of someone who seizes opportunities, of someone not afraid to think the unthinkable and achieve the impossible. Now, I know all of that sounds difficult, but by sitting here today, graduates, you have already achieved something remarkable. And you've done it with the help of an equally remarkable institution. As Lord Alderdice said, the OU is not like other universities, and you are not like other graduates. You know it, everyone on this stage knows it, and your friends and family here today, they know it too. But now you have to go out there and prove it to the rest of the world. You have to go out there and show them what graduates of the Open University are capable of. You have to provide a living, breathing demonstration of what an open university education really means. You have to live up not just to the standards that you set for yourself, but to the standards set by the hundreds of thousands of graduates who have come before you. So aim high, set grand goals, dare to dream, dare to make those dreams real. And if you do all that, your incredible achievements won't end with the qualification we are celebrating today. They will carry on across all your endeavors for many years to come. Now, can I ask one last time for all of us to get to our feet and let's celebrate our graduates and the wonderful university they have graduated from. Congratulations. Good job, everybody. Now, if I can, I'm going to get you to stay on your feet, but this is the saddest part of my job here today. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been my absolute privilege and honor to share this very special day in the life of everybody in this room. But now, sadly, I have to declare the proceedings of this degree ceremony of being completed and this congregation closed. Enjoy the rest of your Saturday, and congratulations.